Labor Day weekend. You may be seated. We have a guest with us this morning, and this is our first Sunday where we have no fans on, and it's just wonderfully comfortable, and so it kind of gets us thinking about fall, and fall gets us thinking, hopefully, about the crop walk. And Steve Damage is the director of the Franklin County Crop Walk, and so we invite him to come forward. I don't know if Steve's ever been to the church, because the two times that he has been here to talk to us about crop walk, it's always been outdoor mass. So is this your first time inside?
I was here a couple months ago for one of your regular services.
Really? Oh, that's right. I remember that. Yes, thank you. I remember you sat in the back. Thank you very much. So not his first time. But Steve, if you need the mic, if not, please let us know what crop walk.
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
I called Father Randy last night to ask if I could come over, and he said, of course you can. And my wife says, you can't go in your sandals and shorts. It's the Catholic Church.
Oh, yes, you can.
Well, my boss wore sandals and shorts.
That's what we say, and we actually take off our sandals on the altar. I'd like to read something for you. It says, religion can be a force of great good or of great evil. By stressing Jesus' teaching of brotherly love, we hope to stand up for what is good and righteous in the practice of a lived faith. This is not biblical. This is not from the book of doctrine or any type of book that you might have in your church. This is what I'm calling a calvo.
Yeah, it's a calvo, yeah.
I just read your bulletin. How perfect to talk about crop walk when this is how you're introduced into the church. In a few weeks now, October 16th, we will be having the 31st annual Crop Hunger Walk for Franklin County. And as you have probably figured out, you're the host. Randy agreed to that a couple years ago. I asked him if he could do that, and he thought, sure I could do that, I'll talk to the congregation. And that's you. You are the host of the brotherly love of the Franklin County Crop Hunger Walk. This is going to be happening on October 16th, right here. We're hoping outside, but we might have to be inside depending on what's happening with the weather. This brotherly love has been going on for 40 some odd years. We've done it for 31 here. All the money that is raised goes to helping our brothers around the world. 75% of it goes to food and shelter around the world. 25% of it comes right back to Franklin County, to either the Franklin County Community Meals, the Hilltop Community Meals, the Western Massachusetts Food Bank is another one. So this is what Christ has asked us to do. I'm not sure about your lectionary, but our lectionary today, I have to rush up to my own church. Our lectionary today is take up the cross and follow Christ. And this is the way we do it here in Franklin County. Don't call me if you have any questions. We have what we call recruiters. Recruiters are kind of your go-to people. I've been told that Randy is the go-to person. And if I announce that too many times, you'll probably just say, no, it's Sharon.
So it's
Holly. Oh, it's Holly. I knew he was going to give me a different name. So Holly is your recruiter for the crop walk. So if you have any questions, of course, yes, you may ask me, but Holly probably has the same answers. Holly and I, along with Randy and the other recruiters of Franklin County, will be meeting up at the Congo Church in South Deerfield in just a couple of nights to get all the ducks in a row so we know what we're doing when we get here on the 16th of October. So I'd like to thank you personally for being the host. We are one of two crop walks in the United States that moves from year to year to year. It's a real pain in the neck. So it's really nice to have congregations as yourself standing up and saying, yes, we can do it for you. So thank you very much.
All right, Steve, thank you very much. So Steve Dave is off to worship up in Burniston, and we welcome him here today. And as you mentioned, our crop walk recruitment rally is on Wednesday at 6 p.m. We had a meeting this past week to plan our meal. Once we get the recruitment rally materials from Steve, at that time, we will then be able to pass them out. So if anybody would like to be a part of our team and do the fundraising so that we can get a nice turnout, maybe this year, a little bit more than we raised last year, that would be greatly appreciated. So after Wednesday, I will have those recruitment envelopes for any and all. And since we did have Steve, and I know that we want to be out in 1 hour, we're going to skip with To Thee We Come and go right on to page 39, the Litany of Supplication. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we fill our lives with your ideals, be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, so that by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. At this point, on this long three-day weekend of Labor Day, I ask you at this time to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor here together. I confess to Almighty God, one and the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the holy apostles, martyrs, and faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and remission of our sins.
Amen.
May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Show us your mercy, Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And let our prayer.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of the heavenly will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, now, and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to the people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Who are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
You have graced us with love and trust in you. Grant us the gift of discernment, that we may live our lives according to your desires and your design. We ask this in the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from St. Paul's Epistle to the Philippians. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but as more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Behold, God is sublime in his power. What teacher is there like him? Who prescribes for him his conduct, or who can say, you have done wrong?
The Lord of God is great.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Salt is good, but if salt itself loses its taste, with what can its flavor be restored?
Hallelujah.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, as you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Now great crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and he addressed them. If anyone comes to me without hating his father and his mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Which of you, wishing to construct a tower, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if there is enough for its completion? Otherwise, after laying the foundation and finding himself unable to finish the work, the onlookers should laugh at him and say, this one began to build, but did not have the resources to finish. Or what king marching into battle would not first sit down and decide whether with 10,000 troops he can successfully oppose another king advancing him with 20,000 troops? But if not, while he is still far away, he will send a delegation to ask for peace terms. In the same way, every one of you who does not renounce all of his possessions cannot be my disciple. But this is the gospel of the Lord.
Such as myself, we defined the very bottom of the salary graph.
Again, this doesn't mean that the work of a teacher or a priest is less valuable than that of an engineer or a computer scientist. Compensation is not the equivalent to the importance of the work a person does or how hard a person works. You know, it's been so miserably hot this past summer. When you drive down the road, and I always see it on 116, and off on the left-hand or the right-hand side, there's farms over there. And as you're driving down there, and you see those people out there working in those fields, I'm sitting in my air-conditioned car, and I'm hot, and those people are out there working in those fields, I know I make more than they do. But that doesn't mean that I work harder than they do, or that their work is unimportant. We have to make the distinction between compensation and work. And I was very impressed to read last Sunday about a guy named Paul English. He's the internet wizard who has made a fortune creating and then selling internet startup companies. He sold Kaya, which compares, you know, travel search engines or something like that. And for that, he made $2 billion. He, like many other generous people of wealth, realized that there is more to affluence than just money, and then more money, and then even more money. And this is why he is giving away a good portion of his fortune. But what really struck me as insightful was his comment about the value of work. He told a Boston Globe reporter that he felt uncomfortable about his kayak fortune, and that when he said this to others around him, that, you know, he just didn't feel right about having this amount of money. He came from a normal middle-class family. Now he had so much wealth, he just didn't feel comfortable with it. And others would remind him, you shouldn't feel this way. You worked hard for your money. But the implication that Paul English heard those words was that the poor people wouldn't be poor if they weren't just so lazy, if they went out and worked more. But you know as well as I do, there's a lot of people out there who simply cannot find a job. There's a lot of people out there in a changing economy that simply don't have the skills for a job. And so it's not about the willingness to work that you're poor. Sometimes you're just poor because you just can't get a job. And then he said something that I thought was uniquely profound. This multi-hundred millionaire, maybe even beyond that, I don't know for sure, he said, but I didn't actually work all that hard. I'm good at something that makes a lot of money. His skills are rare, and that's why he has a fortune that he can now give away, but he realizes that skills are not the same as work. And in this sense, he is little different than any other worker. And this is why he has chosen to take some of his good fortune and use it to help others who are less fortunate. He works hard. But so does the guy in the factory, so does the guy in the fire, so does the guy who, the woman who was the teacher, so do the people in our hospitals, so do priests. We all work hard. But some get more compensation than others, but that doesn't degrade the value of work. And the same kind of respect for work and the worker was at play in our young church. Coder decried the wealth of some of these because it was only possible at the expense of treating workers so very terrible. I've mentioned several times from this pulpit that the coal mine companies, that they cared more about the mules, the donkeys in their mines, than they did about the human beings who were the miners. And those miners and their families filled Scranton's church. They were the people that when Hoder went into his pulpit and he looked out, those were the people who he looked into their eyes. Now these were good, decent, and hardworking people whose lives meant a lot because they were good and decent people. But there were also other good, decent, and hardworking people desperate for jobs, and so they kept forcing the salaries down. Because if you didn't want to work for a nickel an hour, then somebody else would work for 4 cents an hour. And if you got hurt on the job, so what? We replaced you in a second. And so that labor wasn't respected. And Hoder didn't see this as an economic issue. He did not see it as a political one, a conservative or liberal. He saw this as a Christian issue. He wasn't against the rich. He was against the abuse of the poor and the failure to appreciate their work. Now, 5 years ago this October, I went to a lecture with my old friend, Reverend Richard Killow, who used to be over at Sunderland Congregation. We went to Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Amherst, and the guest speaker there was Dr. Gary Dorian. Now, he's a scholar of something called the Social Gospel Movement that emerged at almost the same time as our church denomination.
The social gospel movement is a Christian movement, and it believed that if people suffered because of the effects of politics or the economy, then the church could not hide within sanctuaries. The church needed to be concerned also about politics and the economy, because that's what Jesus did, and he said that's what Jesus should still be doing through his church. And I went up to Dr. Dorian after his presentation, and as I was starting to tell him I'm a priest in the Holy Name of Jesus, part of the National Catholic Church, he interrupted me before I could finish, and he said, Hoder's Church. This guy is coming out of the metropolitan New York area. I never saw him before in my life. And he said to me, Hoder's Church. The scholar knew of us because of the way that Hoder and this church of ours stood up for the worker and the work that they did, and because it was a part of our Christian faith to respect that work. Work and workers work, and they remain honorable words. I don't have a lot of respect for lazy people, but lazy is not the same as poor people. Bishop Hoder often said to those around him, I don't know if I will be alive tomorrow, but if I am, I will work. And he did until his dying day, literally until his dying day. In a church pamphlet from a much younger Hoder in a much younger church in 1901, we were only 4 years old at that time, Father Hoder encouraged us to religious and social activism, and he finished with these words, to work them, because our God is calling us to it. He wanted to change not only the people of the church, he wanted to change the world in which those people live. Labor Day gives us a chance to remember the value and the importance of work and the worker, and in a time when the separation between work and compensation grows ever larger, we need to remember the social gospel movement of our formative years. As church, we need to stand up again for the value of work and the worker. There is a moral point at which too few make too much and too many make too little. And that's when the church, in the name of Jesus, the one who was once a carpenter, who once worked with his hands, the one who sought to found a common good amongst all of us, that in his name, we need to speak out on their behalf. And this Sunday of Labor Day weekend gives us the perfect opportunity to remember this gospel commandment of social justice into which our denomination was born. And for this we pray in Jesus' name, amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar, as a middle point of the 3-day weekend for Labor Day, we pray for all those who are traveling. We pray that they be granted a safe journey. We also pray for all those who began school last week and also this coming week, that all may go well at the beginning of a new academic year. We also offer our prayers for the health and recovery of Al Drake, who had surgery this week at Mass General, offered by Bobby and Mary Ellen Hurd. We also continue to offer our prayers for those battling cancer, Meg Connors by Ellen and Don Skrosky, Randy Clemens by Grandmother Dottie Baronis, Carl Dickinson by Joe and Peg Kostchuk, Fathers Ray Drader, Jan Bielchek, and Maurice Blazell is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families, 2-year-old Jack Sella by Mariana Foster, Frank Skrosky by twin brother Don and the Skrosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families, Liz Richmond, recently diagnosed with cancer and raising three young girls on her own, is offered by Cindy Benjamin, and also a private intention for a friend now battling cancer is offered by myself, and also for Brandon Pope, that the doctors in Boston may be able to treat his heart condition successfully, and for his family and friends during this stressful time, is offered by the Foster and Pope families. And before I ask if there are any intentions from the congregation, I do want to mention that Brandon is at Brigham Women's. Where's Richard? Is it Brigham Women's, Richard? It is Brigham Women's. So he's at Brigham Women's right now. There was a problem with that device that they had inserted to help monitor his heart. So he is out there. They're not sure what the next step will be. And so Mariana and Lynette and their son, and Lynette's son Ben, they've driven out. Renfrew is driving right now to go see him. Richard is still here because Richard's job is to watch the dogs in both houses while they're gone all day. But we do want to keep Brandon in our special prayers at this time, and also his family. I just want to keep you up to date with what was going on with them. Are there any prayers from the congregation? Okay. For all of these prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before you in the privacy of our thoughts, plus we ask you, Lord, to bless all of us here gathered, and to bless all of those who are parish or are unable to be with us here today, and those who are parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made, for us and for our salvation. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sins, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I live for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The Lord be with you. Consider as lost because of Jesus the Christ. We receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith. Thank you. redeem me and be gracious to me. My foot stands on level ground in the great congregation. I will bless the Lord. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Receive this offering, most holy Trinity, which we make in remembrance of the passion, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, in honor of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, and may add to their honor and aid our salvation. May they, whose memory we honor on earth, intercede for us in heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Heavenly Father, grant us true repentance, so that these gifts we now offer to you may be pleasing to you, and that the rest of our days may be pure and holy on this earth. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close. He gathered into the upper room all those whom he loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me will ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. And after these and other words of the Archimedes' prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner, after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, the remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance, as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith, they will become for our souls the saving remedy. We humbly ask, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith, who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who bring life straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings, we ask in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Instructed by our Savior's teaching, And following divine example, we say with confidence, saving Master, awaken me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it last tonight be united with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy of you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you. him, since he lives forever to make intercession for all of us.
The Lord be with you.
Together, always live in peace and harmony with all of your creation. We ask through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Sacrifice of joy, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you, through your mercy may be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe, but only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, and his own did not accept him. Any who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willing, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son, coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.